In this video, we're computing the gravitational self-energy of a uniform sphere with mass big M and radius big R. So the idea that an isolated sphere contains some kind of gravitational energy sounds a little strange at first, but here's the basic reasoning behind it. Over here on the right, we have a reminder of how to calculate the gravitational potential energy between two masses, and that's negative g times the product of the two masses, divided by the separation distance between them, and I'll post a link to the derivation of that fact up at the top. What I want to note for now is that this potential energy approaches zero when the two masses are very far apart, in other words, when R gets really big. And the potential energy gets larger and negative when the masses approach each other. So this means if we think about how our sphere got here, and we'll just start calling it a planet at this point, the planet needs to be built up by accreting small chunks of mass over a long period of time. And every time a new mass arrives, we get a little more negative gravitational potential energy. So this means by the time we're looking at a completed planet, we've added up billions of tiny contributions to the total negative gravitational potential energy, and that's what we call the gravitational self-energy of the planet. Note that one big difference between a planet and the sphere in this problem is that planets are well differentiated, so they have way higher density toward the center, so we can look at this uniform sphere as just a first approximation. So, the derivation goes very much like the real story of how our planet got here. We're going to build it up all the way from the center out by accreting small chunks of mass all the way from a radius of zero to a radius of big R. So in our diagram, we're showing this moment in time where the mass is some intermediate value that we call little m, and the radius is some intermediate value of radius that we call little r. And we bring in a new infinitesimal chunk of mass dm, and note that dm is layered onto the existing mass uniformly over the surface. This means all the new mass is located at a distance of little r from the center. And the energy contribution there is totally equivalent to bringing in a point mass of dm to the surface of this planetesimal. In other words, we can use our gravitational potential energy formula to find the energy contribution brought in by dm. Now, one more thing before we grind through the derivation here. We need a quick reminder about the concept of density. So density is mass per unit volume. That would be measured in kilograms per cubic meter. And we normally give that the Greek letter rho. We also frequently turn around this relationship to say that mass is density times volume. So we're going to use both of these little formulas several times throughout the derivation. So to get started here, what I want is an expression for the potential energy increment brought in by this little infinitesimal mass dm. So we look at our potential energy formula, and that g is just a constant. And then I need the product of the two masses. Well, that's little m times dm, where little m is the mass of the existing planetesimal, and dm is the new infinitesimal mass that we brought in. And their separation distance is given by little r, where that's the current radius of the planet that we're building up. Now, ultimately, what we want here is an expression entirely in terms of R so that we can integrate as we go from R equals zero to R equals big R. And this means we need to rewrite M by using the idea of density, and we need to rewrite dm as well. So just a couple side calculations here. Little m is going to be the density of this material. And again, we're assuming that's uniform just as a first approximation. So there's rho. Times the volume, and the volume of a sphere is 4/3 pi r cubed. So again, the point there is to get little m in terms of r. Now what about dm? Dm is a thin spherical shell, so I can still write the mass of that guy as density times volume, but the volume of a thin spherical shell is given by the surface area, 4 pi r squared, multiplied by the thickness, which we call dr. So now we can plug all this stuff in to our expression for du. So we have negative g times little m, but little m was rho times 4/3 pi r cubed times dm, but dm has another factor of rho and a 4 pi r squared dr. In our denominator, we just have an r. So we're going to make an effort to clean this thing up a little. I can cancel one factor of r. I'm just going to cancel one of those from the r cubed and turn that into an r squared. And then we'll proceed by combining all the constants that we see here. So I have a 4/3 and a 4. That gives me 16/3. So just moving all the constants out in front, I have a negative 16/3 times g. Then we have two factors of rho. So I have a rho squared. Two factors of pi. So I have a pi squared. And then four remaining factors of r. So I have an r to the fourth. And then dr. So there's our completed expression for the increment of gravitational potential energy that we get from bringing in this infinitesimal mass of dm. All that's left to do here is add up all these potential energy increments by using an integral. So the total gravitational potential energy is going to be the sum of all the gravitational potential energy increments. This is what an integral does. It adds together infinitely many infinitesimal contributions and tells you what the total is. So we sub in our expression for du into this integral, and I'm going to move all the constants out in front here, and there's a lot of them. That's negative 16/3, g rho squared, pi squared, and then I have my integral of r to the fourth dr, and this is an r integral, and I have to cover the entire construction of the sphere. And that means I go from r equals 0 all the way up to the final radius that we called big R. Well, that's a simple power rule kind of integral. It just gives me 1/5 r to the fifth. And when I sub in the limits of integration, only the upper one matters because subbing in the 0 just gives me 0. So I end up with just a 1/5 big R to the fifth coming out of that. I'm going to go ahead and combine the 1/5 with the constants out in front real quick. So I end up with a negative 16 over 15 g rho squared pi squared big R to the fifth. So that's one way to write the answer, but it's not really the answer we're looking for. We would like to express this final gravitational self-energy in terms of the mass and radius of the planet. In other words, we don't want the rho hanging around. So we need to find an expression for rho, and then we'll sub that in and simplify. So there's our expression for the total gravitational potential energy. And what I want to do is express rho in terms of the given information about this sphere. So that's our total mass divided by our total volume, which is 4/3 pi big R cubed. So I can clean that up a little bit and write it as 3m divided by 4 pi R cubed. So we'll sub that into our expression for the total gravitational self-energy of the sphere, and replacing rho with 3m over 4 pi big R cubed. Remember, that's going to be squared. We get an expression like that, and then we just need to clean this up. So when I square that expression, 3m over 4 pi R cubed, I'm going to end up with a 16 for my constant there, and that should cancel my 16 right there. Okay, the pi in that denominator is also squared. So that's a pi squared down there, which will cancel the pi squared up here. And then in my numerator, I have a 3 squared, and one of those 3s is going to cancel one of the 3s in this denominator. So that leaves me with a 5 in the denominator and a surviving 3 in the numerator. So let's start writing this down. I end up with a negative 3/5 times g, and I get an m squared in the numerator from squaring that rho term. And all that's left to do here is handle my big R's. So in my denominator, I have an R cubed, and then I'm squaring that. That gives me an R to the sixth in the denominator, and I'm going to cancel 5 factors of R out, leaving me with just 1 in the denominator. So I'll write it like this, just as a quick intermediate step, and we can make our final answer look just a little bit cleaner. I end up with a negative 3/5 gm squared divided by R. So there's the total gravitational self-energy of a uniform sphere. Now, if you like, you could think about the magnitude of this as the amount of energy you would have to put into a planet in order to blow it up back into all the little pieces it originally came from, separated by a large distance. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.